and I'm a senior student here in John Jay. And I'm glad to introduce you to today's event called From Virtual to Violent, the Role of Social Media in Gun Violence. This event is a part of John Jay College's semester-long initiative called America's Gun Epidemic, A Question of Public Health, Security, and Freedom. The Gun Violence Initiative explores this issue in depth using interdisciplinary approach. We are looking at the impact of gun violence on individuals, families, and entire communities. Today's event is co-sponsored by the Citizens Crime Commission of New York, a long-time partner of our college, concerning a variety of criminal issue-related topics. It is my pleasure to introduce you the moderator of this event, Richard Ayburn. Mr. Ayburn is the president of the Citizens Crime Commission of New York City, a nonpartisan nonprofit organization that relies on expert insight to invent and implement effective solutions to improve the justice system, reduce gun violence, stop youth violence, and prevent cybercrime. In his role at the Crime Commission, Mr. Ayburn draws on his experiences as the Assistant District Attorney in Manhattan from 1979 to 1984, President of Handgun Control, Inc., which is now the Brady Campaign, at the Center to Prevent Handgun Violence, and in private practice to identify problems, develop strategies, responses, and implement comprehensive, effective solutions. In addition to his work at the Crime Commission, Mr. Ayburn serves as a president of CAS LLC, which advises police departments, criminal justice agencies, corporations, and other organizations across the country and internationally. He is also one of the managing partners of the law firm Constantine Kanon and serves on the board of directors of several nonprofit organizations. Please find his extended bio among our handouts and join me in welcoming today's moderator, Richard Ayburn.
I wouldn't jump. I particularly wouldn't jump with heels. Hi, everybody.
Hi.
So, I'm going to invite our panelists up for us in a second, and I will introduce them and get this going. But we are a relatively intimate group, and frankly, it's far more important to us that we hear about your thoughts and your concerns and your observations, and if you have them, your suggestions about how to get at this very complex issue, which we will introduce in a second. So I'm literally going to consider this a moderated dialogue of however many we are, 45 people. I will ask our panelists some questions, but I'm not going to stand on ceremony and say, for the last 30 minutes we'll have a Q&A. I really encourage you to put your hand up if you have a thought or if you want to jump in. And I may even look into the audience and say, hey, Edna, what do you think about this? I know you work on this issue. You're not going to hide in that corner. And I know a bunch of you, so a lot of you are in trouble. Okay? So if I can ask the panelists to come up, we'll get going. Rodriguez, get away. On my far left, that's not a political statement. Because there's nobody to my right. Which is a political statement. Michael Rodriguez, AKA Love, is born and raised in the Bronx, and he serves as an outreach worker for Bronx Connect's Release the Grip program. Michael is a former gang member who was incarcerated for a total of 18 years. After this experience, he has dedicated his efforts to change his community and influence young people. Michael is a valuable community member who is credible to reaching out to young people. He began his work at Release the Grip as a violence interrupter and quickly became one of the original outreach workers to begin the work in the East Concourse section of the Bronx by providing case management, mentoring, and referral services to under-resourced high-risk youth and and adults. Michael, thank you for being here. We really appreciate
thank
it.
You.
Now, this is going to be very easy. If you can't remember a male panelist's name, just take a guess and say Michael, and you have a 100% chance of being correct. Michael Perry is a program supervisor and one of the founding members of True to Life, another cure violence program housed within the Central Family Life Center on Staten Island. Mr. Perry is a full-time father of two children, ages 15 and 20, and a gold-selling hip-hop recording artist. Mr. Perry has been on both sides of the gun epidemic and is currently using his community influence and art to move young people away from violence and towards possibility. Michael, you don't know this. I don't think you know it. I don't think you were there, but I spent all of Friday morning in Staten Island talking with community members about Rikers and related issues and a lot of clergy members. And I must say, it was incredibly impressive, the community spirit that there were 40 people that group brought to the table and the ability to work in a collective, collaborative, hand-in-hand way, I mean, across every single divide you could imagine was really impressive. Really nice stuff out there. To Michael's right, Shabnam Javadi. Shabnam is an associate professor of applied psychology at New York University. Her research aims to understand, prevent, and target health and mental health disparities for underserved youth and families with a focus on girls in the justice system. She has published over 40 empirical papers and book chapters and is a recipient of the Caris Award for Research and the NYU Martin Luther King Faculty Award. Underachiever. You gotta get working out there. Her intervention models have been implemented in multiple states and are currently used across the service spectrum in all five boroughs of New York City. To her right, my immediate left, is one of my colleagues, Roberta Liggett. Roberta is a program associate at the Crime Commission and heads up our social media and violence initiative. Roberta has been at the Crime Commission for 3 years now, excuse me, and received her master's degree from NYU in forensic psychology while she was at the commission. With us, she has been extremely helpful in extensively researching how the youth use social media and coordinated the development of the pilot e-responder program, which we will talk about, an evidence-based intervention to prevent violence on social media. And we will get into detail on that towards the back side of this conversation. So why social media and violence? Why not social media and pals and other things? So any of you that are in this field, and I have to tell you, because it's just interesting, this is a very mixed audience. We have law enforcement people in the room that have literally years of experience working on this issue, both as sworn personnel and as civilians. We have people who are out in the streets doing this stuff on a day-to-day basis. We have credible messengers, in other words, people who have walked the walk. We have some journalists, and we have some members of the Crime Commission writ large and some of other Crime Commission staff. So this is a pretty significant audience. It's not a naive audience. So it's a great chance to get into this issue in an in-depth way. So a lot of what I'm about to say, many of you already know, and that is, that over the past, Dermot, how many years has there been a migration from the streets to the social media? Is it 10 years, Kevin?
Ten years
or so. See, I told you. 10 years or so, we've seen this big migration of social violence into social media. We're going to talk about what that's all about. But to give you some context about how real this is, don't hold me to this exact number, but we think around 40% of shootings in New York City are related to gang violence in one way or another, loosely defined. And in New York City alone, just in New York City alone, we know that this risky behavior on social media has led to at least 240 shootings. And that piece of data I know is already a little bit old. 24 murders, ditto, that's a tad old. And the indictment of over 660 young people. That's just in New York City alone. So this panel is, in this discussion, is geared more towards what can we do to bring down the violence that is online. In classic prevention terms, how can we stop it before it gets so hot that it results in a shooting? This is not a panel on intervention, police interventions, law enforcement, et cetera. This is in that area that nicely brings everyone together, which is how do we stop it from happening? So with that in mind, I'm going to start, but again, I'm going to encourage you all to jump in whenever you would like to. Hi there, Mike. What do you think are the dynamics of youth violence in New York City? What do you think is driving some of the violence? People have lots of different interpretations of what's going on out there. They hear the word gangs, they hear the word crew. Lots of different conclusions from it. What do you think it's really like out there? And then I'll probably work my way across this. Either way, guys.
Well, definitely gangs. I would say gangs are a big influence. And that's in my catchment area, that's what we deal with the most. A lot of gangbangers, we have two opposite rivals. Going on, so
and a gangbanger is?
Yes.
Just the people that don't
know. In the catchment area, we have a lot of gang-related incidents. And most of our kids, they deal with that. And what we do, we monitor them through their Facebook and everything. And so we keep a close step on what they're doing, what they're saying to each other. That's provoking one another. And when we pull them in, the ones we know, or the ones that are involved in our program, we definitely pull them in, we sit them down, and we show them, like, what you're doing. Some of them don't really know what they're doing. They're young, got age of 16 to 24. So we pull them in, we sit them down, and we show them, like, what you're doing and what you're saying can cause this. It's a ripple effect. Words is, when you're dealing with gang members, words is very strong, very powerful. Some of them retaliate, they don't want to. It's, they have to, to keep up this image, to keep up being a member of the gang. So
let me drill into that a little bit. So the word gang is a rich word, right? It conjures up all sorts of imagery in American culture. The famous gangs of LA, the gangs of Hell's Kitchen, the gangs coming up from the Northern Triangle, in Central America, Guatemala, El Salvador, etc. It's something that connotes a highly organized structure. In LA terms, multi-generational. I think in Chicago, somewhat multi-generational. We have old gangsters. Is that what it is in New York? Is that what the gangs are in New York? Highly structured like that? Territorial, multi-year, multi-generational? Or is it something different?
It's from what I've...
Or is it many things?
Yeah, it's a single answer. I find that it's more reckless. I'm gonna be real with you. It's way more reckless, way out of hand. Like, I guess in LA, you got these so-called big homies, OGs. And these neighborhoods is like...
What's an OG?
An OG is like, it stands for, I believe, original gangster, but it's somebody that's been involved 10, 15 years already. And you get labeled as OG, so it's like you're a big brother. Like, you're supposed to be teaching the next generation how things run.
In the gang.
Yes. And how to operate and whatever it is they do. And I find that in New York, there's a role model. Even if it's positive and negative, there's none.
So do you have OGs in New York?
As
a way of life in the gang. Not really, right?
Nah, I wouldn't say OGs, but consider an OG an older guy that just came from prison doing 20, 15 years talking to the youth.
Okay, so the gangs in LA, I worked with LAPD for 5 years. We did a lot of work around gangs. The gangs in LA control territories, they engage in extortion, they engage in drug running, they engage in gun trafficking. They literally mark their territory with very particular signs. They're starting to get into some of the cyber-related offenses, identity theft, credit cards, those sorts of things. They're very hierarchical. You know where you stand in that gang. You don't cross them. Compare that to New York. What I'm trying to do is give the audience a bit of a flavor of what the New York gang situation is like from your perspective.
Please. Yeah, so I want to go back a second, because when you want to understand the gangs and the gang life and things like that and the children who are in it, you have to think about the trauma, right? a lot of the youth are dealing with so much trauma, you know, from their household. You know, there's not a lot of love being shown there. There's a life of drugs and crime a lot of times in the home, right? So what that does is that just creates something in the kid. You know, I grew up a lot of trauma in my life. You know, I was my dad was killed when I was 10 years old. I'm just trying to paint a picture for y'all so y'all can get the average kid. You know, my dad was killed when I was 10. Violently, he was murdered. In the same neighborhood that I grew up in, right? I had to walk past where he was killed daily to go to school. So, you know, he got killed one night. My mom took us out of school. We didn't go to school the next day. It was actually on my sister's birthday. We had to walk past the building for the next, every day. But I remember his blood stains still being on the floor. I remember drugs in the home. I remember my mom not choosing the greatest men, you know, after my dad was gone. So a lot of trauma. You know, my uncle went to prison for 30 years. He just came home. The music was an influence. The drugs. So seeing all of that growing up, I mean, it creates something, man. It turns you into something different. I remember growing up saying I wanted to kill the guy who killed my dad. I wanted revenge because he took him from me. You know, I just recently let that go. It's honest for y'all, you know what I'm saying? So we grew up with that. And a lot of kids in New York City, they grow up with this trauma, right? So then we go to the street. And now we're looking for love and we're looking for certain things. So you meet your friend, your childhood friend. It's not always gang, and when you say blood and crip, it could be just a childhood friend. For myself, my childhood friends was my gang. We made our own gang. We didn't go blood, we didn't go crip, we didn't do Latin King. We formed our own gang. And we were just operating out of dealing with the trauma that we all dealt with, single parent home, domestic violence, domestic situations, and a lot of trauma. So that's what it kind of shaped you. By the time you're 13, 14 years old, and you got access, you know, to weapons, and you're popular in the neighborhood where you're from. That was my life. I had access to weapons. I had about 15 guns when I was 16 years old. I had access. I had them in my basement, hid them from my mom. So, you know, that's kind of like the picture, right? Some people turn to gangs, some don't, but the life is what is out there for us. It ain't much out there for us.
So the gang is filling a void, you're suggesting, in some ways, providing some structure that otherwise is not existing. I'm interpreting what you're saying, as existing in life. So that would be wholesale different than you might find in these hierarchical structures in LA and even Chicago, to some extent. Mm-hmm. Shabnam, you're a psychologist. What are you hearing here?
I'm hearing a lot. I think that, you know, my training is in clinical and community psychology for a reason. And part of that is because the impacts of trauma, and I'm so glad you mentioned that, are real on an individual person. And at the same time, the access, right, that one has in a context is also very, very real and very, very important. So I'm hearing, you know, the importance and the salience of, you know, what's important. And I'm really glad you used the word children, right? Because that's what we're really talking about in much of these cases, even if we are talking with somebody who is, Michael, you mentioned 16 to 24, the youth that you see most often. Even if we're talking about a 24-year-old, you know, that trauma in that person's past is real and anchored in their childhood. And I'm also hearing about the incredible ways in which children learn how to survive and how to thrive based on whatever context, right? Kids know what they need. They need connection. They need access. They need healing. But it's really hard to figure out how to do those things. How does a 10-year-old, and thank you so much for sharing, how does a 10-year-old grieve the loss of a father whose bloodstains they see on the streets they walk past every day. There's no model for that. There's no, you know, intervention for that. And so I'm also hearing about the importance of relying on the wisdom that exists from people who have gone through those experiences or have worked with others who have gone through those experiences to figure out how to deal with those realities and at the same time prevent those from becoming realities for others.
Michael P., does this ring a bell on you?
Definitely. Definitely. It's so what happens again also is it's untreated. The trauma is untreated. So we can't leave that out. I never went to speak to nobody. I just had to figure it out on my own. And one day I woke up and I said, I cannot continue to live like this, you know, dealing drugs. So remember, that trauma just created a path for me. I didn't set that path. I didn't create that path for myself. But the trauma, then it being untreated, like the sister said, even at 24, even at 30 years old, some of these men out here are still children in their mind and hurt and broken down. So they're so emotional in the street where it's like, I don't know no other way to solve this problem. I don't know. I've never been schooled. I've never been taught. All I know is one way at 30 years old. And we're in the streets acting off of emotion. We don't have the skills to walk away or to talk about it or to mediate it or to help or even seek the help, right? So you talk about from 16 to 30, some of the 30-year-olds, 35-year-olds, I even have to go higher. They have the mentality of a 16-year-old in terms of what they do in the street and how they act and how they react to things.
Michael R., is this resonating with you?
Yes, yes. Like you mentioned, I gave these people 18 years of my life in jail, so I definitely am a product of the environment.
You got to pull that mic in a little bit.
So I definitely know what it's like. In and out of jail, you come out and it's the same thing. Everybody around you is doing the same thing. There's no resources. There's no community centers. There's nothing but go outside and play, and they there. On every corner.
We're hearing the word children over and over again. We're hearing the word trauma. We're hearing children who are 30-year-old. I think one of you said 35-year-olds. I don't know what the principal demographic is. 18 to 25, somewhere in there.
16.
Where do we go downward? How young are we talking about? Stephanie's my boss.
We have a mic.
There's
a mic there on the stand for the audience. Thank you.
Hey, everybody. So I think, you know, you have to honor the individual's path, right, and see what's going on for them, what kind of resources and supports they have, what kind of access to services, and what's happening. But, you know, you're talking about 10-year-old with trauma. At certain grade level, third grade, fourth grade, you're not passing algebra. They predict when you're going to drop out, right? So we have to look at these factors and implement prevention strategies with mothers who are pregnant and in, you know, social emotional learning and preschool and all these things, because we're talking about coping skills, right? At a certain level, when something happens, stress in the world, we have to be equipped to manage trauma as an individual, unfortunately.
Stephanie Uberall works for the Crime Commission. She's the Director of Violence Prevention, one of the best people in this business. She really knows this area. So, Roberta, this is sounding pretty different than what we normally think about with gangs. We're not hearing a rush to arms, we're not hearing let's get a gun, we're not hearing let's get out and rob, we're not hearing let's go out and pillage. We're hearing a much different presentation from two people who have been there. Much deeper, much more complex psychological factors. When we're thinking about this in a prevention, not an enforcement context, in a prevention context. What else do you think, Roberta's also a psychologist, what else do you think drives people to engage in gang behavior?
Yes, so I think all panelists had this exactly right. A huge driver for joining a gang is definitely trauma. And what Mike Perry was just talking about was a lot of times the gang or the crew fulfills a lot of different needs for a young person. So a lot of risk factors associated with joining a gang really come from a lot of oppression, a lot of insecurity, insecurities, low self-esteem, the fact that it's a supportive network. So a lot of what motivates joining a crew, also what motivates a lot of the activity in a crew, is a lot of like a sense of purpose and a family. So it's really hard to tell a young person, don't be in a crew, don't be in a gang, because this is their family. They grew up in buildings with their friends. That's really just a friend network that they have, and telling someone to walk away from that is incredibly difficult. So just to reflect on what's already been said, a lot of the crews in New York City are very building-based. It's very much wrapped around a friend, and sometimes it can even be entirely structured around grief. A lot of crews sometimes stem from losing someone really close to them, and a crew is a memory of that person. Blocks might be a memory of that person. And a lot of what the crew also gives a person is power and reputation. So when we think about what does this behavior look like, and when you think about young people involved in crews, a lot of what you see is this really bravado, super macho image, very consumed with firearms and explosive violence. But that really is coming from a place of trauma, and a place of need, and a place to get control over their lives. And also, putting that image in front of somebody is very much a defense mechanism against being re-victimized. So if someone knows that you're the baddest person and that you're super tough, they're not going to hurt you, or they're going to be less likely to hurt you. And so this is kind of the behavior of what we're talking about. It's why a lot of these crews, which is what Love was just talking about, look like reckless. Like, it looks like they have no structure because they're really fulfilling a lot of these needs that aren't met, and they are very unstable.
Okay, so you've introduced a couple of concepts here and a new word, which I want to get you to amplify a little. The two Michaels and Chad Evans all saying gangs.
Yes.
You just said crews.
Yes.
Is that something, is that a distinction that you're using, or is that a different construct, or are you using that synonymously with gangs? And does it matter?
I think it does matter. I think that we use gangs and crews very interchangeably. I like crews because I think about this behavior in the context of a negative peer group and not in the context of a structure of what a hardcore LA-based gang looks like. That's really around profit. It's about selling drugs, about protecting turf that's related to making money. This is very much a group of young people that have, for legal reasons, been labeled as a gang. A lot of times they're really just a peer group, and sometimes when the peer group gets dismantled because of incarceration, the crew completely dissolves, which you don't see in a normal, stable gang. I don't know if you guys also have an opinion on crew versus gang.
Absolutely. I think you said it better than I can say it. It's a difference, but it's the same. Because, you know, I had a crew, I wasn't in the gang. It was just childhood friends. We all grew up together. We all from Staten Island, from Jersey Street. Right? One of my crew members is right here in the back filming me today. I grew up with this brother. You know, Jersey Street, Staten Island. So it's a difference. It's not so much structured. It's just neighborhood, your neighborhood, where you're from. You grew up with some people. They wind up being your brothers after so many years. You consider they're really your family.
So, Roberta, the other thing you said was, I'm paraphrasing, sometimes it's just around the building. What did you mean by that?
Yes, so a lot of the crew violence is very contained to a housing project or to a specific TERP, which is why Cure Violence was talking about their catchment area. So their catchment area really tries to encompass these places where a lot of the violence happens, because there's usually a group of kids who all live together in the same housing area, and they loosely form a crew, but they all live in the same building. So it's very much related to their TERP, and a lot of the violence happens completely around their housing and where they live.
Okay, so let's migrate to that now. All right, we spent some time talking about possibly why people join crews or gangs. Maybe the term doesn't matter. A little about what that lifestyle is like, what that lifestyle is fulfilling in the person's life. I mean, we're getting a different picture, I think, than we normally get about what gangs are like. But it is no secret that there is violence within and between gangs, and there's certainly violence in between gang members. Sometimes related to the gang, sometimes not. Have you looked at that issue? the drivers of gang violence?
A little bit, yeah.
You want to talk about that a little bit?
Sure. I think, well, I think to kind of put the question on its head a little bit, I think that most of the research that has looked at the drivers of gang violence has looked at the sort of gangs as you were describing and distinguishing them from the crew structures in New York City. So I think that we really are not as certain as we could be about the drivers of gang violence. For example, one of the main factors that people talk about is profit, and that might not be the case here. Or it might be the case in very different ways. It's not necessarily about a profit model that goes on even when, Roberta, I think as you were mentioning, people from the crew might be incarcerated, et cetera. It is a larger, broader, structural kind of system. When research has looked at the drivers of gang violence in smaller, more kind of along the structures of the crews that you all were describing, people talk about the role of grief as being hugely important to the drivers of violence. And people talk about the role, sort of the lack of outlet for expression, defined very broadly. Because if you really, really, really define violence broadly, even though it is, in its physical manifestation, terrible, right? It is a means of communication. When you engage in an act of violence against somebody else, you do it in particular ways or under particular contexts. It tells something about sort of what you intend to communicate. And so that some of the research that I'm aware of in this area talks about sort of violence as the sort of last resort form of expression of something when other options for expression fail. And I think here, this is a very important link to probably what we'll talk about later around sort of social media also as a form and platform of expression that is obviously linked to violence. And then of course, grief and how we know that people oftentimes express their rawest of emotions in sometimes impulsive ways, sometimes ways that are unanticipated, that you can't really predict. That they are expressing in response to grief sort of really, really in very, very raw ways. And then there is a kind of a loop that happens, especially for kids who are in peer networks with other kids that they're friends with, when, let's say, that something happens and there's a child who's grieving, and then they express that grief or part of that grief through violence, that doesn't end there. That's not sort of the ultimate outlet, right? So research would suggest that it's what happens after the expression of that violence. Something is provided. And I think that people have not looked at that issue necessarily enough to ask, why does violence continue to exist and permeate? It serves a social function. What is that function, and how can nonviolent things serve that similar function and serve it obviously in a better way and without the negative consequences that come with that?
So this notion of trauma and grief keeps coming up over and over and over again, and it's interesting. Every time one of these two ladies say it, you two shake your head. So this is resonating. This is resonating. You're hearing something here.
I'm surprised by how on the spot they are with the information. I'm truly surprised.
Just because you don't know them. They're always like that.
You know, because they sound like they have the experience.
Roberta, do we need to talk?
So I wanted to touch on something that I heard earlier. How it spreads is because the cure violence model in itself is under the assumption that, and I agree with it, that violence is a disease and it's spread. Spread. You can catch it. You can catch it. You can catch that violence. You can catch that mentality. And it's a mentality. That's what the disease is. It's a mindset. That can latch onto you and get you sick. And then you'll have no way to shake it if you're not treated. right? So I want everybody to think about that, you know, violence as a disease. It truly is a disease in my eyes, because it was because of the things that I've seen and that I've went through, it changed my mindset. And it spreads from me to this brother, to people that I'm around, to people that you're close to. It's a mentality, right? And it's a, and we've been, in the ghettos across America, we have been going through this for far too long. I think what Cure Violence does is now we use these experiences, some of my brothers in the
Can I just ask you, wait 1 second, yes, before we get into that, because I want to do a lot of, Michael, same thing?
Yeah, it's definitely a disease, because if you're in a crew, if you're in a gang, and one of your gang members is upset, he wants to lash out, and there you go. Just that quick, you're moving with him.
So take us into that a little bit. What is someone, or what are? By the way, before I do that, I just want to put a footnote in here in case there's anybody in the city here, beyond those of us that know each other. Roberta, I think, mentioned, but did it quickly, and I was going to go back to it, forgot to, that a lot of kids are homeless. They engage in something called couch surfing, which is something that's been popping up in the research that we do, both qualitatively and quantitatively, more and more, and I believe is really under-resourced by the city. I don't think the city has caught on to the fact that this is one of the drivers of some of this youth violence. They literally have no place to go. The kids are already destabilized, based on what you're saying, who literally have no home. Not metaphorically, literally have no home. Think about what that does to an individual who's already challenged. So what is some of the kind of violence that you think emanates from this world that you used to inhabit? What are you seeing out there? Are they shootings? Are they, I think we've had some retaliations? Are they what we used to call, when I was in the government, dismurders, disrespect murders? Jealousy? Is it
instigation? Not investigation.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry,
instigate the situation that. Two young men having a simple fight, fist fight, and one loses. The first thing you see anyway when something is happening in the city is everybody's pulling their phones out. Instead of helping the individual, people pulling their phones out. So it's being recorded, and now you posting this up on your page, so the opposite, which they call the ops, that's the opposite of what you're claiming in your hood. They're posting it up, now you see comments, oh, he got his whip, that's good for him. You're seeing that, you're feeling some type of way. Your crew's feeling some type of way, because now it makes us look like, oh, we don't do nothing, man. Then that's it.
So this doesn't sound like an organized gang out there protecting their boundary at the corner of 125th and 8th. This sounds more like two individuals who have gotten into a beef, and this is somehow getting amplified. Am I right? Am I interpreting what you're saying correctly? Do you think a lot of the violence is that? We call it gang violence. But do you think a lot of the violence is that it's just interpersonal disputes, or is there some actual violence related to maintaining the integrity of the gang, turf protection, et cetera? Or both?
I would say, but it's much more than the gang and the crew thing. A lot of stuff is spontaneous, you know? And the men and women, they don't have the tools to shake it or to get away from it. What happens is now, like the brother said, once it gets on social media, now it's a show. Now we're performing for the show. We're performing for the crowd. We don't want to do it. I'm gonna tell you something. I'm gonna say something to everybody in here tonight. You know, I'm gonna say 8 times out of 10, when there's a conflict that gets broadcast on social media or whatever, these kids are dying for somebody to step in. Nobody's stepping in. Like the brother said, they're pulling their phones out. Nobody's stepping in. So I can think about stuff that I've been through in my life. I was dying for somebody to step in. But if ain't nobody stepping, then I gotta do what I gotta do. But we're performing for the crowd now. We don't really wanna do it. You know, but now that there's a crowd involved, I have to do it because I can't go back to my neighborhood. I can't look like a sucker, you know?
So shut up. We're hearing New Dimension now. Now we're hearing behavior that is not just between two people, but behavior that may have started out between two people is now migrating into social media, these are the apps, assuming you're meeting in some online environment. There's some amplification taking place. What's going on here?
I think you hit the nail right on the head. I mean, I think that there's a performance aspect to it, and there are now new social consequences for ignoring it, even if you really, really want to ignore it, right?
Social consequences within the gang or crew.
Social consequences within the gang or crew, or social consequences within anybody who now has access to view whatever is on whatever online platforms, and it's also no longer in your control, right? You might be tagged in something, and then 10 other people might share and reshare it, and now that is being broadcast to not just your network, right, whoever that is comprised of, but other multiple networks. And so I'm hearing concern about, you know, reputation. I'm hearing concern about the possibility for a dynamic to really move much more quickly than it would have outside of an online platform, because you have access immediately, and it can sort of take on a life of its own in a way that the people who are directly implicated in it lose sort of control over, right? Lose some agency over. And I also am hearing the kind of the incredible pressure of kids who for whom we know that peer networks are the most important things in adolescence, right? That's one of the reasons why adolescence is such a difficult time period in general, even if everything is going really, really right, because it matters tremendously the identity that you are cultivating, because you're doing it in reference to your friends, your partners, your possible partners, right? And so now to have the pressures of having to develop your identity on an online platform that you don't fully have control over, while simultaneously having to defend your reputation and being indirectly or directly encouraged to use violence to do so, is just all the key ingredients for violence to happen.
In theory, violence could be forced on somebody as an identity.
Yes.
So let me put you on the spot a little bit.
Okay.
The answer is, not sure, that's totally fine.
Okay.
You have no idea. What is it about this relationship between adolescence and identity?
Mm-hmm.
Why is that such a driver in those years as opposed to in later years or even earlier years? And maybe just for this purpose, you have to define what years you mean by adolescence as relevant to this time.
Sure. So adolescence, you can think of it from sort of early adolescence starting around 11, right? Sometimes 10 through like mid-adolescence, 14 or 15, and then really what's being described as young adulthood, which is right around that 16 to 25 age period. Those times are developmentally incredibly important. Your brain is experiencing the most changes that it has experienced since you were an infant, which is insane. I know, I have a 1.5-year-old. He's impulsive and totally spontaneous. So your brain is experiencing those kinds of changes incredibly rapidly. Essentially, to say it very colloquially, you're becoming really capable, really smart, able to understand that you don't just have one identity, but you could be different people when you're with different people or in different contexts. And so you need that constant feedback. So like, I'm with my friends, this is what I like to do, this is who I am here, this is who I am at home, this is who I am at school. And that process is incredibly important, essentially for the cultivation of what we need for survival to some extent as human beings, which is a balance between independence and living collectively.
So take me down that road a little bit, because in the setup to this question, you talked about identity, and I think you said either peer pressure or peer acceptance, something around peer structure. As I think about it, and I've done some work around this, it's, to me, it's not just identity as an individual.
Yep.
It's the identity of the adolescent as part of some collective.
Mm-hmm.
And so how much of the interplay is dependent on the sense of the individual being housed in the sense of the collective?
Yeah.
Do you follow?
I do follow. A ton. So it's kind of like you have a sense of self, but then the people who are important to you are constantly holding up a mirror, is kind of like the metaphor that I like to use, to you and showing you back who they see you as. So it's incredibly important that you're cultivating that identity, not by sitting alone, you know, thinking, who am I, who should I be, how might I get there, right? You're doing it in interactions with other people almost completely. And you know, that's why there's such a push, I think, for adolescents beginning right around 10 and 11 years old to explore relationships with many other people outside of their immediate families, so that they can understand who they are from the perspective, from the eyes of other people.
So this is a two-part commercial break. The first is I want you to park something she just said, because as we get towards the latter part of this conversation, I hope we have time to get into something that we're looking at the Crime Commission increasingly, which is what's the intersection between big data and AI and the ability to more, in a more nuanced way, analyze these triggers at an earlier and earlier age. I want you to park that for a second. The second part of the commercial break is this conversation around adolescence. There's a biological component here, right? The prefrontal cortex, which controls emotional control, impulse control,
planning,
decision-making ability, consequences of action.
Yep.
Has not yet fully developed. Is it the last part of the brain to develop?
Yes.
This is why we push this concept called RTA. It's a political commercial. Raise the age. So hard in this state. We're in our fifth year pushing for this. Why? Because this state, and I hope it's not provocative to anybody here, but this state is one of two states in this great union that has the audacity to prosecute 16 and 17-year-olds as adults. As adults. Is that blunt enough? And you don't take 16 and 17-year-old kids and treat them as adults and put them in the adult penal system. It's lunacy. You're guaranteeing future criminal behavior. But yet we persist year after year because we can't get a bill to the legislature, even though we know exactly what to do. This may be our year. I'm told this could happen. So please stay tuned. We're going to have to be putting a lot of pressure on. Okay, that's the end of the flip. Roberta, I hope this doesn't come out in a provocative way, guys, but it may. A little bit of what I'm hearing Shabnam say is that peers, I mean, adolescents hold a mirror up to themselves and they get the feedback from the peer group they're dealing with, and it sort of creates their own image, their own self-image. Both Michaels talk about a rough start and not exactly being sure, I mean, I'm translating, but not exactly being sure who they were, where their footing was, where they were going to find their grounding, where they were going to find their group support. If they go into a gang or a crew, for me, if this book is interchangeable, is that image sort of, does that become the image they have? I'm a gang member, I'm a crew member, and that's kind of it? And what do you do about it? If that's true, how do you think about that? That's pretty scary.
Yes.
I mean, we're talking about 16, 17, 18, we're not talking about 4 or 5 years.
Yeah, so for all young people, your friend group is probably one of the most important parts of your life. You start to do things together all the time. Sometimes you mimic the jokes and the mannerisms of people that you're with. I think that when in a crew, there's been a lot of research to kind of show how a crew kind of moves together towards a socialization that accepts violence as an appropriate response. So when you create these networks that are surrounded by trauma and surrounded by a need to be seen as tough as a form of self-protection, a lot of times your friends and other crew members are going to really reinforce and facilitate kind of like a low empathy way of responding to other people. So having, what I mean by low empathy is kind of disregard disregarding the feelings of other people and not taking their perspective when in arguments, which is also pretty difficult to do as a teenager anyways, because in adolescence, it's a very self-focused transformation. You are really concerned about your identity, where you fit in the world. And I think a lot of people don't give a lot of credit to the idea of identity and psychological needs as being as important as other needs, like hunger and housing. Like, being part of a group and feeling important is so critical to the human experience. So when you're in a crew, you're going to start being reinforced by your friends. If it's really cool to be seen as really, really aggressive, everyone's going to give you praise for that, and it's going to start to be adopted in a way in which you interact with the world. And I think that the low empathy is something that's really facilitated and reinforced well in the crew. Sure.
Okay, so now we spent about halfway in, okay? Tonight. About halfway in. I want to lay a very, and hopefully, good, solid foundation of why people are drawn into this way of life, what are some of the psychological factors going on, what the life is like, you get this real sense of despair, and why it is, I'll use the same word, why it is such a desperate situation. Let's now shift over to social media and cure violence, and then ultimately how we think about intervening. Remember, it's almost an epidemiological approach, right? We're trying to identify what the malady is. Now we're going to talk about how it's transmitted. We're talking about it as a disease. And then we're going to talk about intervention. This is a prevention conversation. It's not an enforcement conversation. So we need to understand the drivers if we're going to design the intervention. So let's get back to social media. Roberta, you've spent a lot of time with us thinking about this, writing about this, talking about this, and out in the field working with it. What the heck is it about social media that is just driving this issue in such a hard way? Why is it so troublesome?
Yes. So, as we pretty much alluded to during this conversation, that there's a lot of problems that young people experience on social media. So, just to break it down kind of generally, everyone has problems with social media. So, I'm sure everybody in this room has been in a Facebook argument, has seen fight videos, has seen the president tweet, all these things happen. So,
I told you, none of that. Public institution.
So, and I think it's really common because of the way that social media is structured. So a lot of the mechanisms that go into using social media, it's what makes it really fun. It's also what makes it really problematic for some people. So some of these things is having a huge, large network. So we think about how important it is to have friends, and now we have access to thousands of friends just through Facebook, and getting likes for certain comments and for certain content is really gratifying. And we see this in the research. It activates different neural pathways that are associated with addiction, which is like super crazy when you think about it. But so it's very good to be liked. And when we talk about needs and a human need to be powerful and respected and have self-esteem, this can be a really big way to get that. The only issue is that your network is kind of like a ghost. When you think about how you use Facebook and how Facebook is structured, I'll use Facebook as a perfect example, because they select what turns up in your newsfeed. Half the time, you think that you're talking to a handful of people, because they're the same handful that likes everything that you like. They're the same handful that you see on your newsfeed. And then all of a sudden you'll post something, and that leads to a lot of oversharing. And then you forget that your network is actually much larger. So this brings people into a space where they can have, people can get fired or have school discipline because they shared something that they thought would be liked by their friends, forgetting that their friends is really thousands of these other people that encompass a lot of different networks. The other big thing is the one-to-many communication style. So when we post on social media, we're broadcasting. We're not posting usually one-on-one anymore. It's not like AOL Instant Messenger. It's very much you're posting a status for the world to see. So you're curating this image, and when you post to everyone, it facilitates a very self-centered way of thinking online. And it also creates a disjointed type of communication style. So the way that we communicate now, because of social media, because of texting, it's not a fluid conversation between two people that you would have on the phone or in person. It's one person says something, writes something, minutes go by, and then another person is thinking about what they want to write, curating what it's going to look like, and then they post it. So a lot of this disjointed communication and the fact that you're not even looking each other in the face anymore creates the opportunity to have a lot of low empathy on social media. So we talk about arguing. This is really common because you're not thinking about the other person because you don't see them. You don't have to see the pain on their face.
So it sounds like road rage.
Yeah.
All right, so that applies across the spectrum of social media.
Yes.
Now, stay with me. Uh-huh. Now bring me into youth violence.
Yes.
Why is this such a driver? Why is the PD seeing so much activity online? Why are we seeing these shootings in the streets that originate online, et cetera?
So a lot of what we're seeing is it's very much taunts, threats, arguments, posting of videos of fights. All of these things have the potential to really amplify and accelerate conflicts. So a lot of these conflicts might not always originate on social media. They might have been a physical confrontation at a later point. But what social media does is it opens the net of who gets involved in the altercation. So being able to share, being able to like, being able to comment freely means that more and more people are sucked into the conflict. A lot of them feel empowered to comment on your page about things that they might not actually understand. And this really amplifies the entire situation and creates higher stakes to the point where if someone is taunted or threatened, they almost have to respond now. They can't just ignore it anymore.
Okay, so let's desensitize. That was a perfectly abstract application of the rules. Give us some real examples of what this is. Tell us cases, you don't name any names, but tell us cases you've seen and where we track them from the beginning right through the end, which ends in a death. What's going on out there? Give us, if you can, 3 or 4 or 5, if you can, examples of where either things start on the street, migrate to social media, and come back, or they start on social media, however you want to do it, but desanitize this thing.
Yes. So part of my research and trying to think about social media and how you view social media is that I keep track of all of the news articles that pertain to social media and violence. So there's lots of different examples. In the city, there was a case where someone posted a video of himself taunting another crew and taunting the memory of somebody who was shot by their crew and hours later was tracked down at a party and killed. And this happened in our city. There's other instances where people are getting in violent assaults because of an argument that they've had online where they're close to death. There was one girl who was assaulted in the bathroom. The video went all over the internet and she ended up passing away from her injuries, and that was because of an argument over a boy. We have issues where someone will get in a fight, someone records it, they post the video, tag the person who was beat up in the video, and then that person has to now fight someone else. And then it keeps going and going and going because of the public shame. And if he wants to retain his reputation, he has to respond just as violently.
Shabnam, you've done a lot of work around women and violence, which is not normally an area that gets a lot of public attention. We tend to think of violence as a male phenomenon. And I would suspect, if you look at the vast number of shootings historically in New York City, I don't know the numbers, but I'll bet they're 98% male. I don't know the numbers, but I'll bet it's in the upper 90%. But what, and I don't mean this in a flip way, what's the role of women in all of this? We don't generally talk about women in either gang or crew violence or social media violence. We hear about murders over jealousy, we hear about murders over girls or women being this, but more broadly, what's the role of women? And what are you thinking about? What are you doing about it?
I appreciate that question. There's a lot of different ways to, I think, answer that question, but I think for this conversation, I want to emphasize a couple of things. The first is, to take kind of a historical analysis and understanding in many of the states in the U.S., but mostly also in very productive, very mobile urban spaces and places, San Francisco, Oakland, Chicago, certainly New York City, et cetera. One of the things that has happened over the course of the past several decades, as I'm sure you know, many, many people in this room are aware of, is the targeted mass incarceration of black and brown men across cities, right? And so that is, we have to start there in order to really understand the role of women in violence and what's sort of happening now in women's use of violence and in girls' use of violence. Because imagine what happens, and for many of you, you don't have to imagine, you've lived it, you've witnessed it, in communities where there is targeted violence against that results in death or serious death or injury of younger men, fathers, brothers, uncles, etc., right? And for those folks who are not succumbed to injury or death through that violence, there is four who are removed from communities through processes of mass incarceration. So who are the people left in those communities, right? By and large, women and children, right? And what happens when you are given an impossible task to be the primary head of a household in a community that has been divested in so many ways, in such rapid ways, right? In ways that remove your access to both basic needs, as Roberta was mentioning, housing, food, etc., but also fundamental sort of needs and rights that people have, like access to support in some kind of way. Those particular neighborhoods, right, have had to have women, and in many cases, young girls, and not exclusively, but in a majority of cases, take on incredible caretaking roles, incredibly stressful roles of holding down those communities in many different ways, while the men that they love, their uncles, their fathers, their brothers, their partners, come in and out and in and out, if they are lucky enough, and I say this, you know, in this way intentionally, if they are lucky enough not to have passed away. And so that kind of trauma, that traumatic thinking is also going on in the back of your head when you have faced with these tremendous responsibilities. Well, what you do in those situations and what happens after multiple generations of that pass by is that women and girls see themselves, cultivate identities, to link it to our past conversation, around being able to survive and take on multiple different kinds of roles. So if there's a scarcity of resources, somebody better go get access to those resources. And if our, you know, boys and men are sort of have been historically removed from communities, then women and girls are going to increasingly take on those roles. And what we see now is in youth populations in particular, among almost all crime categories in the juvenile legal system, crime is down or the same for adolescent boys. Crime is up for adolescent girls, including in relation to violent crime. And so we don't know exactly why those pathways are occurring, but we do know that for girls even more than boys, which is a tremendous amount to begin with, there is an incredibly important role of victimization, of sexual victimization, of very, very early victimization, combined with this intensive social responsibility to take care of oftentimes younger siblings, cousins, et cetera, that are happening almost at the same time, that are colliding together. And then we also have very, very problematic dynamics of sort of the violence that's happening in the community and in the streets replicating in the home. So we have girls and women, of course, experiencing violence then at the hands of those men who they love, right? And in a way that I think creates a situation that is almost impossible to escape, right? And you mentioned, Michael, when you were talking about your mom after your dad passed away, that she didn't choose the best men, right? And I really appreciate the thoughtfulness with which you characterize that. And I would, you know, if I could be so bold, I would even sort of challenge the word choice that you used in terms of what choice did she actually have, right?
In the sense of choice being a voluntary decision versus some, why don't you even explain to me the other word choice?
Choice in its broadest form is you have the full menu of options available and you make a deliberate decision and say, I want this, mm-hmm. right? When you have a very limited menu of options and when you also are choosing that in a community that is taxed entirely, then the word choice becomes a misnomer. Yeah.
Okay, so we've got this gang situation, we've got these Kids Who Are Destiny's gangs, we have this accelerant from social media, we have this amplification from social media. Everybody agrees, anybody who's involved in this work knows that we're seeing this reemergence back on the street. It is horrific. The question now is, as we start to think about the last 45 minutes here, what do we do about this? How do we intervene in this stuff in a constructive way? Does everybody in the room know what the cure violence methodology is? Everybody does? I'm just going to jump into it. If you don't, just raise your hand. Okay, great. So you two guys are involved with cure violence sites, one in the Bronx and one in Staten Island. Why not, if you would, just describe a little bit what your day-to-day life is like, what you work in your cure violence sites, either at Bronx Connects or at the Staten Island.
I start my day, I come in, I check in with my team, make sure everybody's feeling, because, you know.
Well, who is your team?
Our team is Bronx Connect, located in the Bronx. And the reason I say I check in with my team, we call it a chop it up, because we all have our own personal lives. And you can't come to work carrying your own personal issues. So that's the first thing we do, we check in with each other. If one of the brothers ain't feeling right or something's bothering them, we get to it before we go. Get to work because you don't want to carry that.
Is your college?
Yes, it stops you from listening to the young man or the young woman that you're helping. So that's the first thing we do. We come in. Me, when I was a VI, I come in after
violence interrupter.
Yes, violence interrupter. I hit the streets, walk around the neighborhood. You know, it's like I hunt. I go out hunting, looking for the knuckleheads, or just to see if I see something wrong. So I go.
See, everybody knew that term. That had resonance everywhere here.
So, you know, I do that, and then when I became OW, an outreach worker, it matured me way more. It gave me maturity too, because now I have a lot of young men's lives in my hands. And the choices that they make are basically my responsibilities now.
And so then you both, and does that resonate with you, that sort of that day-to-day activity?
It's the same process. I'm the program supervisor for the Cure Violence Initiative on Staten Island. Same process. I could be up in sitting in the office, but I don't. Because I'm also a violence interrupter, outreach worker, hospital responder, right? I do all of those things. You know, my reach in the street doesn't work just by me sitting in the office. So I'm out there with my team every single day. Doing the work, running into our participants. We have 36 high-risk participants on our caseload stat now. We have 37 now. These are all high-risk individuals. When I say high-risk, one of the criteria is a weapons carrier, a recent victim of gun violence, somebody who recently came home from prison, right? You know, somebody in the gang, right? So these are criteria for being high-risk. And then, knowing your area, where you're from, I know Staten Island. I know who's who out there, right? So that's what's important. You got to know who's who. So it's the same thing. Check in with the team. We hit the streets for a couple of hours. We run into our participants. We're giving out literature. We're changing the mindset. Let me go here really quick. I need to paint this picture for y'all. Because in terms of changing the mindset of the people, that's a part of the work. Our job is to save lives. That's it. It's a really I would say to some people would say weird. Wow, how do you guys do that, right? Just right off the rip, initially us being having these experiences that we have, us being on this side in the streets now pushing peace, that right there is changing the mindset of the people. Because you have an Iron Mike on Staten Island now talking about peace to the young brothers and sisters. That in itself is very powerful for them.
By the way, the data that just came out validates that movie.
Yes.
I hope you know that. It validates the notion that in the areas where there are cure violence sites, we're seeing change. This is not research we did. This is totally independent research. There is a change in attitude on the streets, which is fantastic. So, Shabnam, what do we do with this? He's out there. He says, we want to save lives. They're describing the methodology. You know the cure violence methodology. When you think about designing prevention programs, intervention programs, what do you think about? What elements do you try and build into them? What do you look for in the programs? Perhaps you've done some yourself. Why don't you talk about that a little bit? In other words, what's the methodological side of what they're talking about?
Mm-hmm. How would you sort of study this to understand? How would you maybe take apart what elements of the model that you all are talking about, and how might you study this in research in order to understand what's happening, what the impact is? Is that what you're asking?
But A, I want to know, and maybe you're including this in your description, what do you think are the elements of a successful intervention in this realm? I know there's lots of realms out there. What elements would you look for to make sure that they were there if you were writing an intervention? What would you write into? Again, this realm, not with women.
Mm-hmm. Sure. I think it's important to write in elements that are going to target the factors that we think, and really that the folks who have lived it and are out there on a daily basis think is actually causing the problems to erupt in the first place. So an intervention would have to really centrally think about the role of trauma, because you all have mentioned it, that is something that plays an important role. It would have to, I think, take into consideration the people who are in and of the community and that have cultivated roles that are much more important than any role that I could play or somebody coming outside from the community and entering the community could play. And so understanding what those roles might be and how best to position those people, right? So you're talking about team-based structures. That sounds right on to me. In terms of making sure that there is some kind of a hierarchy, so that there is some communication going on, so that we can respond to, I forget what you call them, the high risk participants. Mm-hmm. Right, and then I think that you would want to think more broadly and ask, are we talking about, 16 to 25 year olds in general? What works for them? What do we know about what works for 16 to 25 year olds in general? And what we know is that the intervention has to be one that respects those people, that respects that they're making choices for a reason, right? As opposed to, or maybe respects that they don't, that they have limited choice, and still within that limited set of choices, they make choices for a reason, and that really zones in on the strengths that they are displaying. So, just to use your words, Michael, what are the strengths of the knuckleheads that you encounter, right? I know I'm sure you use that term, in partly at least in an endearing way. They're doing things that are impressive. They might not be applying those skills in ways that produce impressive or wanted outcomes, but they are smart. What are they doing? That is smart. How are they demonstrating their smart and their savvy? And how can an intervention or a prevention program cultivate that while not asking those kids to leave the context in which they have cultivated those skills? So, why the secure violence models don't just pluck people away from their communities and put them somewhere and say, oh, look here, this is so much nicer for you, go, right? Because it's completely unrealistic to what they have developed and the places and the spaces and the people that they are a part of.
Yeah, we see this failure of displacement all over the world. No matter where I work, we're governments have tried to displace people out of violent neighborhoods and want them in sanitized areas. In other words, people won't go. People want to be in their homes, however they view it.
Yep.
They want the homes. The long project in Rio, we ran into exactly this problem.
Right.
The city of Rio built massive, beautiful complexes for people to move to. Nobody would go. They said, let's fix my home.
Right.
Roberta, it sounds to me like we have some good old-fashioned cognitive dissonance going on here. Chavna's talking about this pretty sophisticated understanding of individuals. She didn't say this, but she's sounding like she needs to spend some time with these people. You know, these guys need to have some one-on-one touch time with them. And what we know is that the drivers of violence are happening online. So how do you take what they do and what she described and think about it in an online environment in order to effectively intervene? Is such a thing possible? And what have we done about it? This is commercial number three.
Yes, so definitely. So as Shabnam was saying, we need to have an intervention that meets young people where they are, where they're having conflicts, and social media is that place right now. So the Crime Commission and all these wonderful people on this panel all came together and created eResponder, which is an evidence-based intervention that is meant to address this very problem. So eResponder has two big main components. We wanted to make sure that we were addressing and responding to the actual violence that was occurring on social media before it escalated into real-world violence, like assaults and shootings and murders. So we very much wanted to integrate what Cure Violence does as violence interrupters. So on the streets, Cure Violence goes out, they know who's having fights with who, they actually go into the middle of these altercations, de-escalate it, and then have all the kids go home and then come back to their site and then practice all these skills and talk about goals. And then we wanted another component that really honed into what Shabnam is talking about, which is practicing these long-term beneficial skills that they need. So things like emotional regulation, talking about systems of oppression, having a safe space to do this, which is our youth leadership program. So that is what eResponder is. We piloted this model for 6 months with these two peer violence sites. And the results were amazing. People who are actually trained to be aware of what is on social media and what's happening on social media and how they can use their techniques plus additional techniques around grief and emotional management were able to intervene quickly and identify all of these risky social media posting better than someone who was not trained in this. And their youth had much more positive outcomes. So these positive outcomes that we're talking about is that these young people were able to sit back, think about their goals, think about how their behavior facilitates a cycle of violence, reframe problems, all of these really important skills that teens in general have a difficult time with, but people who've experienced a lot of trauma have a particularly difficult time doing. And the youth leadership program actually moved a lot of youth to think more empathetically, which is something that I was talking about being a huge problem on social media. It's very, very hard to do on social media, and we were able to get people to take a step back and think about the other person and their feelings and where they were coming from.
So we're training the VIs, the outreach workers, secure violence people, to actually sit in front of a screen, look at the postings they're going across, and now, rather than having to work with that person face-to-face, they're actually intervening online and bringing down the violence using all of these traditional techniques.
Yes.
You were shaking your head. Does this sound right to you?
Absolutely. Yes. Just to sort of draw out the component that Roberta talked about, which is that it's evidence-based, is that we drew, there is no other, when we came together a couple years ago, there was no social media violence interruption model to draw on. There were models that treated youth with, you know, varying levels of sort of respect and choice, and that were more about cultivating strength and less about sort of punishment or painting youth in a negative light, I would think about programs like anger management as being kind of the opposite of strengths-based kinds of programs, most of those. So we looked at the programs that were much more about youth's own own strengths and meeting them where they're at, as Roberta said, and drew out elements of programs that had been effective for youth that also had these characteristics of being strengths-based and also had had a good reputation of working with communities that had experienced trauma. And I think came at it with the framework that, you know, one of the critiques that the kids who we're talking about get a lot from society in general is that they don't engage, they're disengaged, they don't have literacies. Why aren't you reading more? Why don't you write a little journal, blah, blah, right? They get this kind of feedback a lot from society. And I think early on what we did, because we knew about the amazing work that was going on, Steph and Roberta, you know, brought this really, like, shed a huge light on this. The amazing work that was going on early on was suggesting that these youth are not disengaged, they are highly engaged, they are highly literate. Where are they literate? On social media. Okay, so let's start there and figure out how we can engage them in spaces and places where they are clearly comfortable engaging. And to your point, you know, we hypothesized that maybe they would also want to have somebody ask them, hey, are you okay, right, when they post a brief picture. And usually people don't do that, right? So I'll say just one more thing in terms of the results. One thing Roberta didn't mention was the effect sizes that we saw in these results. These are ridiculously large effect sizes for interventions. So, you know, you can have a program that has an impact because it shifts, let's say, the number of interruptions that are done on social media by like 10%. We're talking about, you know, having, you know, 180 interruptions with high-risk posts compared to like 5. Right, without this kind of training. It's a very, very strong effect size that we're seeing, which is super amazing.
So, thank you for that. Yeah. That was not a setup, there was no money past it. So, I'm gonna just do this myself, because I wanna save some time for questions. We have an innovation lab at the Crime Commission, which we call the Predictive Prevention Lab, thinking about predictive policing. And this is the first product we've rolled out of that, and we are just thrilled with the way it's hit. And in fact, we are now rolling it out not only citywide, but we're having conversations in Mexico, Brazil, and Argentina, where there's some interest in it, and some other places around the country. And we have a meeting tomorrow afternoon with one of the other big peer violence providers, which is just about this. There are going to be two more iterations of eResponder. The basic model, which we've now rolled out, relies on these guys watching their screens and seeing posts where they have to intervene. We are done with Fast One. Is Fast One finished?
We're in beta.
We're in beta on Fast One. So Fast One is going to be a Snap-on tool that's going to sit on top of Facebook, and it's going to actually be culling through the Facebook posts and triaging them and sending alerts to the VIs so they know what is the post with the most immediate threat of violence, some threat of violence, and a non-threatening post. So they know where to put their attention because there's just so much out there. And then that's Fast One. And then Fast Two, which we're getting close to having, will be utilizing artificial intelligence and deep tech cognition to actually, the machine will actually teach itself to track how the language of violence changes so that we can stay current. The language of violence online is a language onto itself. And if you don't speak that language, you won't know what's going on there. We need artificial intelligence to have the machine actually teaching itself so that we can track violence, the language of violence, as it evolves. And just think about the applications of that. And we're very close to having that. We'll be rolling that out.
Yeah,
We'll be rolling that out. And she says, no, I'll tell you the answer. We'll be rolling that out soon because we need FAST 2. We really need FAST 2 because language will just keep evolving. And we need to make sure we give you guys the tools you need to remain current with this. Okay, so with that, I'm going to wrap up this portion of our program with a hearty thanks to you four. You are crystal clear, and I don't know what you are. And I'm happy, we're happy to take any questions. Nothing's off bound. Kevin?
And can you please, can we pass the mic around, please?
And since we're taking this, would you mind identifying yourself? And if you don't want to, it's okay, I will.
You want my online handle?
Either one of
them. My name's Kevin O'Connor. I'm the Assistant Commissioner of the Police Department. I do social media for the police department. First of all, I want to thank you for what you're talking about. I was relating to some of the language you were using. But just an observation real quick before I ask them a question about the gang shift that we're seeing. We're talking about Facebook stuff.
I'm sorry, Ken?
We're still talking about Facebook.
Why are we talking about Facebook?
But what I'm saying is we're looking at Facebook, Facebook, Facebook. Where kids are teaching us what we need to know. We have the whole system backwards. The violence interrupters are in this world, so they know where to look and what to do. The problem we have is you have kids, and I have six, so you're only a third of the way there, right, Michael? You have to look at the whole perspective. We can't catch everything these kids are doing. And you talk about the girls online. Every girl fight in New York City is on World Star. And then we wait for the get back or the part two. And it's the whole language every day. And it's all girls. Where are the mothers? The mothers aren't in this world. It's backwards. Kids, parents will talk to the kids about drugs and what to do and how to protect themselves, but they don't talk about social media because they don't know social media. This is 10 years in the works, tops. This is the first generation that's living in that world. We have to get the other generation, you know, the 40s, 50s, 60s into this. Yeah, they're on Facebook. We're not talking about Facebook anymore. We're way past that. And we're into the Snapchat world. Okay? But it's still the same conversation parents need to have with kids. So I just want to bring that out, that it's great that we have them looking in the right places. But the bigger picture that's addressing the whole world is we have to get the other generation back in front, not behind. We got to switch the horse and the cart. What I have to ask Michael is, we saw a change in the gangs a couple of years ago where we saw the organized gangs, Bloods, Crips, Trinities, Latin Kings, evolve into more of what we're dealing with now. The Bronx with the local sets, and we saw some umbrellas with Young Gunners and Young Bosses, or 600, 900 in Brooklyn. Are you seeing this going back to where we were 10 years ago? Are you seeing the crews getting morphed back into the bigger groups again? And it's just a question, just from an observation of Wissing. Just want to see if you guys are seeing that on the street.
I wouldn't say it's going back to how it was, because back when I grew up, it was a lot of morals and principles. Yeah. Even the negative role models in your hood wouldn't allow you to do certain things if it was going to interrupt what they had going on in the neighborhood. That was out of the question. And even if they knew your mother, they'd smack you upside your head, and get up off the block, you interrupting, you interfere with their money.
I don't mean in that sense of the word. What I'm talking about is when we might be talking about MMG or AIO morphing more back into, I'm a blood set now, I'm a Crip set.
You mean smaller gangs and crews going to larger?
They're losing smaller identity and jumping into the bigger world again. Are you seeing that in your area? Where more people are playing in blood, or Jack and Crip, or whatever, rather than your little local set on the corner or on in the building.
Yeah, I would say that, but like the brother was saying earlier, it was always crews, and it could be a big blood set, but at the end of the day, it still boils down to little crews on each block. These guys could be blood up the block, we're blood to hand, but at the end, we're this crew and that crew. But at the end, when the indictment comes, it doesn't matter. They take it all of you. So I see with all these indictments happening, I see
things making a big turn. I can tell you that. Like, a lot of people are like waking up, especially these young kids, like they're not realizing, yo, I'm on indictment, I didn't do anything. Mm-hmm. You didn't do anything. You was just jacking this, you was just banging this, and it's too late. Once you're in the system, you're part of whatever they came for.
I would say to try to help you with your question. A lot of the smaller sets are becoming the main thing where I'm from. You know, it's not about just Blood and Crip anymore. These younger kids are coming up with their own thing, and they are getting bigger than what the Blood and Crips may have been in that time. So that's what I'm seeing on Staten Island. You know, it's not too much Blood and Crip anymore. And like the brother said, it's not going back. It's getting worse because the kids are more reckless today. There's no morals and principles anymore. You know, because if you know what the gangs started off as, it really wasn't a bad thing. You know, I mean, Crips stood for community restoration, improving something. So it wasn't initially a bad thing. Blood has a positive name. Brotherly love overriding something in depression. I mean, these are positive things. So, and it were morals and principles, right? So I think it's not going back to those positive, because a lot of positive that came out of the game, a lot of negative as well. But I don't think it's going back. I think it's getting worse because everything is so reckless now. The kids have no feelings, and it's really bad out there.
I saw a hand here and then here.
Richard, he's got
the mic. Oh, I'm sorry. I saw a hand here. You migrated over there. I was trying to find you.
Good evening. Chaplain Michael Alvarado. I'm actually program supervisor for Bronx Connects Release the Grip. I'm glad you brought up the topic because it's a topic that can't be ignored in the distinction and the differences. And I'll leave it back to my peers and my brothers in arms to take it from there. But the key distinction of gangs and crews was that honor code was the system. Speaking from personal experience, growing up, you didn't want the block to be hot. You didn't want attention on the block because modes of money needed to go through the block. You needed to keep the block safe and keep your neighbors quiet, and you wanted to look out for your own because that was the only means. So going back to trauma with, I know him as Iron Mike Perry, was talking about trauma growing up in our neighborhoods, and the main reason for that consistently being a problem is that there is no outlet. Back to Dr. L. Sharon, there's no outlet, and our means of outlet is molded and shaped into our communities. And because of that, we outlet the best way we know how, which is through violence. I had the privilege and honor of being a part of the pilot program with the Crime Commission, commercial, right? And what I saw in it and the potential in it of being very effective is that it provides the resource, the greatest resource that is the most undervalued in our communities, aside from money, aside from the social services, aside from mental health services, aside from jobs, aside from, you know, all the disparities that are evident, right? Because we can go on and on and on about what's evident about the social and economical disparities in our community, but what's the most effective is the social construct, the life skills building is what our communities need. And I say ours because by the age of 18, I had been shot, I had gotten stabbed, I got my head cracked open, my nose broken, and I was pronounced dead on the operating table twice because I fell into that mode and that path that was laid out for me of violence because I was in a single parent household. And actually the systems that were in place that were supposed to assist actually kept us there longer or kept us there and hurt us more than actually helped us. You think of the juvenile justice system. You have the PINS program. So the information how it's portrayed to a family in the urban community is, if your kid is out of control and doesn't go to school, which is one thing to look at, your kid decides he doesn't want to go to school, now you get an ACS case, and now ACS is in your home, checking the fridge, so on and so forth, right? And we can go into the plethora of different services that are supposed to help, but actually hurt the community more, because then it removes people out of the community, which you yourself said doesn't work. Going back to the point, I don't want to take much more time, but the social skills, the life skills, how to deal with conflict, empathy, how to identify the feelings of another and changing the perspective and the dynamic. And going back to gangs and crews, there is no honor system, there is no code of ethics anymore, and what we see it driving as it being on the ground, and what's most important is getting people like us that are credible for a reason provide the proper training and resources and outlets so that we can then feed that to our communities, because now they trust us. Our communities have already developed the mindset that we cannot trust the system, because the system has already been against us for decades and millennia. So we need people that look like us, that's been through what we've been through, to tell us, look, this is the proper way to go about this. I've learned it, I'm using it, and this is how it can work out for you. And this is what it looks like.
That's great. It's also the community helping the community.
Yes. Right?
And before the next question, just give me 60 seconds to add on to that, because I want to paint a clear picture of what Cure Violence is and what it looks like. It's not just a group of men who have these experiences who are pushed out on the street to say, yo, go save some lives and go talk to the youth. No. It's a lot different than that. It is that, but it's much more than that. We have wraparound services that we offer to youth, right? We have GED programs. We have fatherhood initiative programs. I'm in the schools 3 days a week dealing with the younger kids, intermediate school, public school. We're Staten Island Mental Health, substance abuse, right? Project Hospitality. We're linked in with all of these wraparound services to help these kids. So it's one thing to go tell a kid, put the gun down, stop shooting. They'll say, yo, I ain't got no money, I ain't got no health insurance, I ain't got, we have all of these wraparound services to help them. So I need you guys to understand what Cure Violence is. It's not just a group of men with these experiences out there in the street telling kids to stop shooting. It's much more than that. We have a lot of resources for them.
This is an unbelievably important statement he just made, because the Cure Violence sites, in addition to the direct one-on-one interventions that they do, and do so well, and the data supports that, they are what we call a very sharp portal into communities that can be very hard to reach because they're either inaccessible or untrusted. And these guys get to those communities in a way that I don't know of any other entity in the city that does it, and they're able to provide services. They're the conduit for the services that are so critical. So that was a phenomenally important statement that you made. Reverend?
Hey everyone, you're hearing from Bronx Connect. I'm Reverend Wendy, I'm the Executive Director of Bronx Connect, and I'm just so glad to see staff from Staten Island here, true to life. Can my Bronx Connect staff stand up? I know I'm putting you on the spot. Come on, Freddie, you can do it. Smile, smile. So, I want us to step back for a second, and I didn't hear it, but fatherhood is an issue. Right? So we talked about the fact that our fathers have been taken away from us by a beast that starves us. And I always tell the kids we have to starve the beast. There's a somewhere upstate that someone is counting on their bonus or their employment by your incarceration, and we're gonna starve this beast. You're not going to jail, right? So our fathers have been taken away for a generation. And really what traditionally the fathers gave this identity to the children, right? And worked with their mothers so that it wasn't only one person fighting for the family, but two, it's no longer there. But the second thing I'm gonna say is employment, right? One of the reasons I believe that New York City is experiencing this low violence is that we are experiencing employment. We are growing in our ability to employ people, and people really want to work, right? And then finally, I'm just gonna say this, because Bronx Connect, I kind of feel like we are half Black and Hispanic. I think we're 100% Black and Hispanic. We were a growth of the Black and Hispanic church in the South Bronx being challenged to address really high risk youth. But we hire men, and these are them. And we always say this, we were hiring credible messengers before anybody called them credible messengers and before Bloomberg told us we had to, you know, because we knew they were the best. Because they came from these neighborhoods and they weren't afraid of our young people. So this is my encouragement. We need to see our men and we need to uphold our men. And I'm a woman and I don't have a problem with Women Month and all that stuff. But our communities need our men. We need our men. We need our men to take responsibility for their seed, right? Because they need to be the papa bears. But we also need our men to take the lead. So I'm always excited to see my men up there. And you did real good. Yeah. His name is Love.
Thanks, Reverend.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Right up front.
Hello, my name is Kareem Nelson. And our organization is on Wheelchairs Against Guns. And I sat in and I listened. And a lot of the time, I feel that the cure is addressing the culture. And when I say the culture is me, him, and every violence interrupted grew up the same. And that stretches all across the globe. And when I say that, I could go to California and exist. I could go to Chicago and exist and be safe. That's because I know the culture. I come from the culture. And the culture is somebody put their hands on you, put your hands back, don't run around my house, tattletale, always be a man, watch how people talk to you. And the part of my culture when I'm coming up, the people that I look up to are the guys on the corner, the good basketball players, the boxers, the men with the women, and the drug dealers. That's our culture, am I right?
Absolutely.
So when we address that and we look at that, so we have to find the problem and the solution in our culture, right? And in our culture, I heard a lot of things like, I heard the word sucker, I heard the word punk, I heard the word I can't do this. And what's lacking in our environments now is conflict resolution. You know, in my culture coming up, I didn't even know what it meant. Only way that I knew how to resolve a conflict was violence. And through my violence, the result was gonna be respect. Like, and my critical thinking, we don't know how to think at all because I let money take me all over the state. You know, I let little thoughts deter me to where it put me in a wheelchair, it put me in prison, in a wheelchair, you know, and then positive self-esteem. Our youth are operating on a very low positive self-esteem. So we talk about social media. So when we talk about social media gives us gratification of people liking us. We might not know these people, but they like what we're saying. So now I could feel like I'm somebody. You know, I could turn on my phone, I could turn on the computer, and I could be somebody with a million followers, but I'm worth $10,000. You understand? So that's where you have to address the problem. And social media is working its way into our culture. It's giving us a way to identify ourselves. It's giving us a way to be respected. It's giving us a way for people to look at us. It's giving us access to millions and millions of people. And then when you throw that into the melting pot of mental health, throw that into no job, poor schooling, no community centers, you know, false big homies or big brother, whatever y'all want to call them in the hood, it's a melting pot for disaster. So what is really the cure? How do we address it? How do we get to it? You know, I come to a lot of these. I hate to be pessimistic, but I come to a lot of these. And I always hear the problem, the problem, the problem. But what is the solution? How do we get to the solution? The lady, I don't know how to pronounce her name, but everything you said was dead on point. We have to address the culture. And the culture right now is getting worse and worse. Like you said, right now the culture has removed principles and morals. You know, the ladies in our communities don't feel safe no more. They don't feel safe. Like when I was in the street and we sold drugs, we shut down when school stopped. We shut down when the old ladies came. But they never called the cops on us. You know why they never called the cops on us? Because they felt safe. You understand? So we have to address the culture. And once we find out addressing the culture, which is teaching our young kids how to solve conflicts without violence, bringing up their self-esteem, not only you feel special without the Jordans and the nice clothes. You know, we have to teach them how to think. Because when they go to the gun, that's all their culture teaches them. Their culture is not, yo, let's go talk this out. That's not a part of my culture. My culture is a part, if you do something wrong to me, I have to inflict that. I know no other choice. Because what comes from my balance is going to give me respect in my neighborhood. I'm going to be able to walk outside. My future, you know, offspring is going to be good. So we have to address the culture, and once we address the culture, we'll find our solution. That's just my personal opinion. You know?
So I just want to make a comment and give you a shout out. So Roberta's going to chat with you right after this a little bit about the basis for these programs. These are based on conflict resolution techniques, so I want to, you know, understand. I just want to give them a shout out. When I was running the National Gun Control Movement, which was not an easy time in Washington, these guys were superheroes and coming down to Washington time after time after time, getting up in front of Congress, going up to the White House, going up to the Justice Department, going to the Treasury Department, and talking about what real-life gun violence was like on the streets and what the real-life consequences were. And I took, it wasn't you guys, but I took some guys, some of your colleagues in L.A. to Hollywood, and I said, stop this bullshit of
putting in these this fantasy romanticized view of gun violence. This is what gun violence really is. People that walked in the morning are in wheelchairs in the afternoon. People who saw in the morning were blind at night. People who played basketball the night before and are now crippled. That's what gun violence really is. So, man, I'm just really honored you're here and so happy to see you're still at it. These are long, tough, hard fights, so congratulations. Yes, sir.
How are you doing? Damon Bakel from DCJS, and just to let you guys know, I'm the director of training for all the SNUG programs around the state of New York, so it's the same thing as cure violence. So, you know, my question to you guys is...
SNUG is guns spelled backwards. Right. One of the most clever acronyms out there.
Very, very simple, right? Yeah. But I really want to ask you guys, because this is one of my big things that I talk to our people that are doing this care violence model is, I know we talk about the youth and we're talking about trauma, but what are you guys doing for yourself to address some of the trauma that you go through? Because a lot, what people don't understand is that we're asking you to go back in the same environment that you came from, the yes, same sir. Places that traumatized you, the same places that you had these hurt feelings, seeing your father's blood is that in that same building you're probably working in still to this day. Yes, so what are you guys doing to take care of yourself? Because this can be very traumatizing work, and I really worry about our staff going back and doing the same thing that they were doing before, but just with a different lens. I always, my equation is always, we're asking alcoholics to tin bar, mm-hmm. you know, and so what are you guys doing for yourself to take care of yourself?
That's a great question. I can speak about what we do on Staten Island. We have a health and wellness session that we have twice a month. This is sent down from, I think the name is Mary Pendergreen's group, right? She's amazing. Her whole staff is amazing. They've been dealing with us for the past year and a half, 2 years, and we have, a health and wellness group twice a month, which helps us cope with stuff that we've dealt with in the past. We've made amazing strides, as far as the staff, and we've been able to use their teachings and sit down with our participants and the victims of gun violence in our community and use what they gave us. I done found out so much about what I've been through, the clinical terms with these sessions. And it's sad. And it's like, okay, this is what I'm dealing with, or this is what I dealt with. So we have health and wellness on Staten Island, True to Life, twice a month. So it's been amazing for us.
Thank you for that question. That was an important question. We have time for one more.
My name is Rachel. I've been on my own since I was 14 years old without parents, and I was affiliated with Latin Kings. Now, when you said you spoke about trauma spoken about a lot, which I agree with, but so is abandonment. And you made a great point, survival, right? So when you get involved in certain things, survival's a thing. I also work as an outreach worker, and I'm a credible messenger for True to Life. And we work in Children's Village. And what I've learned is there's a lot of emotional abandonment. And there's no aftercare for these young girls or young men after they leave. These programs are crucial. And they need to build more because at the end of the day, there's nowhere for these kids to go. So after they're treated in a program, they're let out back to the same environment with no hope. So what do you expect? It's a statistic waiting to happen. So working with True to Life, it was a blessing to me because I ended up realizing that it's deeper than survival. There's addiction, there's misplaced anger. You know, so gun violence is huge. It comes from domestic violence. So your boss might have cursed you out, you know, and you take it out on the person that you see on the street that you haven't seen in a while. So there's a lot of things that's happening. You know, it's deeper than just gun violence. So I think that True to Life addresses so many things, domestic violence, ACS, all of these things, but where's the aftercare? So I think these community, and what aftercare does True to Life offer?
Well, so I think all of our work starts just with a simple conversation. Before we get to the wraparound services, the clinical terms of what you're going through, I think it's just a conversation with a young brother or young sister to let them know that we care about you. You know, you don't even know how many times, how far we've been able to get with that initial sit down with them. They're so blown away and stuck. You see it in their face that they've never heard that. A stranger, what do you mean you care about me? They're defensive, right? But once you get them to really, truly believe it, that's the start of the change, you know, in the kid. You can save a kid's life by what you say to them. You know what I'm saying? And before I end, I just got to thank Stephanie and Roberta and the sister here really quick publicly. I need to thank you guys because you've been able to study what we've been through, right? Let me say that again. You've been able to study our experiences and come up with these clinical terms and turn it into something positive. Sometimes people study our experiences in our lives and the outcome is not so positive. So I want to thank you guys for the eResponder program. We've been making amazing strides as far as interruptions and mediations. So I sincerely thank you and I wanted to do that publicly. Thank you.
I almost dare not step on that closing, but I'm going to flip down on you and say to you that for me, it's always very sobering to be out with people who are doing the work on a day-to-day basis and to understand what all of you, from you, in very honest ways have been through and how you have turned unbelievable trauma and unbelievable grief and frankly very frightening, life-threatening experiences around into something that you're willing to apply to their community and help with their community, and I know you all do everything that you possibly can. So you are the ones to be applauded. We're honored by your presence. We thank you so much. I certainly have learned something tonight as I do in all these sessions. I hope you have too. I thank you all for being here. Thank you.